Thank you to Francesco for this kind invitation. It's a pleasure for me coming back in Trieste after my PhD. This is actually the first time that I'm coming back, so I'm very pleased and I feel like at home, so thank you. So what I would like to talk to you today is about regularity of Boltzmann equation that we saw introduced by Laurent this morning, and especially something about the regularity of Boltzmann equation when we consider this equation on bounded domains. So this is a joint work that we did with Yang Guo, Chan Wo Kim, and Ariane Trescard. So the results that I will present here are mainly taken from the paper that we published there. Okay, sorry. I will restart. Okay, again.
This is just for the record.
Parlo. So let me thank you for this introduction and thank you, Francesco, again. It's a real pleasure for me being here. So I would like to present to you some results on regularity theory of Boltzmann equation in bounded domains. This is a joint work with Yang Guo, Chan Wo Kim, and Ariane Trescard. So we will consider the Boltzmann equation that was introduced this morning by Laurent in a form that depends even on the space variable. So with respect to the one you saw this morning, we are considering the inhomogeneous Boltzmann equation where we have the dependence on time, space, and velocity. So our function of the density f will satisfy this equation where you see the presence of this term that is precisely due to the fact that f depends even on x. So we have a free transport operator, the first one, and the collision operator. The collision operator is more or less the one that Laurent introduced this morning. So this Boltzmann equation was introduced to study the dynamics of rarefied gases and it places itself in between the microscopic description of a gas, that means like considering the gas as an infinite number of particles, and the macroscopic description of a gas that means considering the gas as a continuum. So the collision operator, as you see here, is made up of a collision part that is due to the gain term, that is the positive part that was introduced this morning, and the loss part given like this. Now, I will just enter a bit more into the details. Let me firstly have a commentary on the free transport term. So we suppose that we have a monatomic gas made up of identical particles that are not interacting between themselves, but they are just moving without any external forces. So in the absence of external forces, the particle are just moving at constant speed along straight line. So we have straight line of this type. So a particle that starts at a point xv in the phase space, so in, let's say, omega times r3, will move at a velocity v to the point x plus tv. So whenever we require that the function is a constant along this line, so ft x plus dv v is equal to f0, for example, xv, then f satisfies the transport equation, which means that dtf plus v gradient xf is equal to 0. So this is the transport equation. We are not considering collision between two particles. And particles move along straight line. We will see that this equation is very important for us to understand the behavior even of Boltzmann equation. I will explain you why. So, however, we have to introduce, because we are considering particles that collide between themselves, the collision operator. So here you can see more or less the same hypothesis that Laurent was stating this morning. I just underline here the collision between two particles. So whenever we have a particle v that interacts with a particle that has a velocity v that interacts with a particle with a velocity v star,
the corresponding velocity after the collision will be this v prime here, where we have this w that is in S2 in the ball, so it's a unitary vector defined like this. And then for the other particle, the velocity will be v prime. So I don't want to enter much into the details of all this stuff. I will just present to you our collision operator, as Laurent introduced this morning, with a kernel that is done in this way. So you have the last term of the collision operator, that is the number of particles that changes their velocity, and the gain term, that is the number of particles that will have the velocity v, defined in this way. And in our case, we will impose some condition on this kernel. So you can see here a particular version of the collision operator. So this is the kernel that we will imply. And we will so the kernel will be dependent on the modulus of v minus v star to the power k, where we require that k is in between 0 and 1. That means that we are considering an R potential. And we have the presence of this q0, that is an angular cutoff, that we require in this way. So theta is the angle between the two velocity v and v star, defined in this way. So these hypotheses are made in order to let things simpler and in order to be able to integrate the kernel and do estimates on the collision operator. But actually, we won't really see the operator in all these 2 hours lessons. Not really. So let me just leave it like this. So we are supposing R potential and the presence of an angular cutoff in order to make all the computation simpler. Okay, so as I told you, Boltzmann, when studying Boltzmann equation, usually we would like to find the existence and uniqueness of solution and to see the time decaying of solution towards an equilibrium. An equilibrium that is a global Maxwellian as the one introduced this morning. This is what we do in general for every domain. What we will consider today is a domain that is bounded. So we are in presence of a bounded domain because maybe the gas is inside a box or something like this. So we need to understand the interaction of the gas with the boundary of the domain where it is confined. So we will require some boundary condition, and of course we will have to consider the interaction, so the collision, not only between particles but even with the boundary of the domain. So suppose that we have a domain omega that is sufficiently regular so that we can write its border as a function with a C2 function. We will decompose the boundary of the domain in 3 parts. So this is our domain. We will have these gamma minus that are the particles that are on the boundary, so that are more or less here, with a velocity that is incoming. So that has a scalar product between the normal, this will be the normal, maybe not like this, but like this, that is negative. This is the incoming boundary. Then we will have the outgoing boundary, gamma plus, that is made up by particles that have velocity that goes outside. So the scalar product is positive. And then we will consider the grazing set that is made up of particles that have a velocity that is tangent. So the scalar product between the outer normal is equal to 0. So this will be gamma 0. So we will see that actually this set is the most important one because it's the set that creates the singularity for the solution. I will explain to you why. So this is the decomposition of the boundary. Okay, so once we have a boundary, of course, we would like to impose some condition. So the condition will be imposed for incoming particles, so on gamma minus, so on this set for particles that are incoming. So the easiest boundary condition that we can impose is just prescribing the flux of the incoming particles through a function g, as written there, is the inflow boundary condition. We will require that incoming particles will have like a velocity given by the function g there. So the distribution of the incoming particles is given by this function. Then we can, for example, require that we have a specular reflection boundary. That means that whenever this is our, in this direction, omega is here, a particle comes from here,
This is the normal, and it's reflected in this way. So this is a reflecting boundary, and you can find the definition there, where we explicitly write how we can find the reflected velocity starting from the incoming one. Then I can have another boundary condition that is the bounce back reflection, that is the particle hits the boundary with a velocity and come back with the opposite velocity. So it's just reflected in this way. And then there is another boundary condition that is like more a stochastic probability condition, in the sense that when the particle hits the boundary with a velocity v, then it's reflected with a velocity that depends on the average of the other velocity. So it's not really well determined. We just know that it's going outside and can be whatever. The point is that the average of the density, the average of the function, is given by this condition where we have here the global Maxwellian with a temperature T that will be actually the temperature that the gas will have after the collision with the boundary, and will be reflected like in a diffuse way in the space. So actually we don't really have the control on the velocity that the particle has after the collision with this boundary. Okay, so just a slide on known results about the existence and uniqueness of solution. We have some results that are for weak solution and that exist like the Pernalion's solution. So we have a list of people that work in this direction. We will work more on the perturbative framework. So we will be able to find existence and uniqueness results for stronger solution, but solutions that are closer to the global Maxwellian, that the equilibrium that we saw this morning. So the first results were obtained with a particular, with domain with particular geometry by Ukai, Asano, and Giraud. And then there were results on general domain by Guo. Then, as far as the time decay towards an absolutely Maxwellian of this form, written here, we have results by Laurent and Villani that say some polynomial rate of decay in HK spaces, and then some results by Guo with an exponential rate of decaying. So just to give a picture of the previous results on this part. And then what about regularity? So this will be like a summary of what you will see in the detail afterwards. These are some existing results on continuity and formation of discontinuity for solution of a Boltzmann equation on bounded domain. So in a paper in 2010, Guo was able to prove the existence and uniqueness of solution, of a strong global solution, in this perturbative framework. I will enter into the details sooner. He was able also to prove, no matter about for any boundary condition that I showed you before, actually, he was able to prove the time decay towards the absolute Maxwellian with an exponential rate. And actually, the most important thing that you have to remember in this case is the fact that whenever the domain is strictly convex, then it is possible to prove that the solution is continuous away from the grazing set. I will show you immediately why this grazing set is the worst set that we are considering. Just remember that away from this grazing set, you can prove that the solution is continuous. We will understand why. And actually, 1 year later, Kim proved that it is possible, in the case of a non-convex domain, to prove that there is a discontinuity, actually, that can be formed exactly starting in point of non-convexity of the domain, as you see here, and entering inside the domain. So this was the result of Kim in 2011. So this is just a picture to let you understand what I'm going to explain you in the following slides. Okay, some regularity estimates were obtained previously in the case of Vlasov equation for BVs and estimates, Sobolev estimates, and older regularity by Yang Guo, but for the Vlasov equation, not for the Boltzmann one, and in the case of for the equation in a half space, so a very particular case. And then they were generalized for Vlasov equation in convex domain with specular bounded condition, two older regularity results.
But in the case of Boltzmann equation, very rare results existed up to the results that I'm going to present you. Okay, what's the perturbative framework? So we take the global Maxwellian defined in this way. So it's the exponential minus v squared over 2. And we look for solution of the form f equal to the square root of mu f. So we have that now we are imposing that our f is given like this. So it means that if the equation for f was this one, now the equation becomes, I just substitute, mu f square root mu f. So now the Maxwellian does not depend on time, so this will be the square root of the Maxwellian dt f plus, and the Maxwellian does not depend on x, so I can turn it outside. Scalar product grand x f equal to q, and you remember that q was the q gain minus the q loss, evaluated in square root mu f twice and here as well. So I just have to divide by the square root of mu here. And I will call this term is the gamma gain. And the other term is nu, how did I call it? It's like nu square root mu f f. So this is to explain why now the equation for the little f is this one. Okay, so from now on, we will consider this as the Boltzmann equation to, in which we will work. So I just write here the form of the kernel, but it's precisely the computation that we just did. Okay, so since we changed the equation in a way, now we have to change the boundary condition accordingly. So we just have to divide by the square root of mu. In this way, for inflow boundary condition, for diffuse boundary condition will be like this. For specular boundary condition and bounce back boundary condition, we won't see because we divide in both sides and we can remove the square root of mu. So no problem. Okay, once you consider Boltzmann equation with an initial datum, actually, so you fix the value of the solution at time t equals 0, you need a compatibility condition of the initial datum with the boundary data, of course, because you are imposing that at time t equals 0, the initial datum will be over here, but since will be defined up to the boundary, it has to satisfy the boundary condition. So we will need to define this compatibility condition for the initial datum that precisely consists in requiring that the initial datum satisfies the boundary condition. So the inflow boundary compatibility condition, the diffuse is there, the specular reflection, and the bounce back reflection compatibility condition. So in the assumption of our theorem, we will always require that our initial datum will be positive and will satisfy this compatibility condition with the boundary condition that we have here. Okay. So let now enter a bit more into the details of our of the geometry and of the behavior of characteristic for our problem. So we will require that omega is a bounded set that is smooth. So we will require the existence of a xi function so that omega can be seen as the negative part of this function. So the set of points that are negative here. And for this reason, the boundary will be exactly the set of points that will be equal to 0. So whenever we have this, we will say that the set will be strictly convex if this quantity, this inequality is satisfied. So in this case, it will be strictly convex. And will be easy to compute the normal because the outward normal will be the gradient of xi with respect to x over the modulus in order to have modulus 1. Okay. Now, characteristic. So the characteristic ODE of Boltzmann equation actually is a straight line
as soon as we don't touch the boundary and we don't have any interaction, is a straight line with constant velocity. So the derivative of the characteristic with respect to s will be the velocity, and the derivative of the velocity will be equal to zero. So we are precisely moving along straight line of the type that I write there. Now, we have to see the interaction with the boundary. So if we are on our set, for example, we take a point here, x, v. So let's say that v is in this direction. It is important to see which is the time that this straight line needs to touch the boundary backward. So this will be our, actually, the time needed will be tb xv. And the point that we have here will be xb xv. So we are going backward, coming back to see when we touch the boundary. Of course, when we take a point here, it can touch the boundary, but if the time that we are considering, here I'm not considering time, but suppose that I take a time t, if t is less than tb, I will never touch the boundary. It means that the condition, the initial condition, will be reached before the boundary. T means that I start from zero, and at time t I arrived here, but if t is less than tb, it means that I stopped before, by the initial condition. Okay, so this is the backward exit time. And now we will see that actually with the definition that I've given of backward exit time and backward exit point, the set of grazing particles that was the gamma zero actually will play an important role. Why? Because if we consider, let me see if, yes, I have a point of non-convexity here. So let's take this point here, xv, and consider a closer point here, not so close, but kind of, that is x prime with the same velocity. So I want this velocity, and I want this velocity here. Now, I try to come back. So for this particle that has this x and v, when I come back, I precisely reach this point. So xb will be this one. And actually, I reach the boundary on a point x that be, such that xb, xv, v belongs to gamma zero. It's a grazing point because this vector is tangential to the boundary. While if I do the same for this particle, actually, and I come back, more or less on a straight line, I will arrive at the point that is very far from the other one. So actually, the time needed to go there is much longer than the time needed to go there, and the particle, the position that I reach here is very far. So this is x prime v. So we see that in the presence of such a boundary with a non-convexity, then we have a singularity, of course. So why we have a singularity? I was saying that we were looking at the Boltzmann equation, but think of a simpler case. Is this the case? Yes. You have a stationary transport equation, this one, so you don't have time. You just have the transport term with a position in this way. You don't have the initial condition because you don't have time, but you just have the incoming flow condition on the boundary, for example, there. What's the value of f at the point xv, in this case, is precisely the value of g on the boundary. So it will be g xb xv v. So it will be g xb minus x minus db xv v v. So if the time is discontinuous, even if I take something that is very regular as a boundary, as an inflow boundary condition, the solution won't be continuous. So the fact that the time tb is not continuous will introduce a singularity in the solution. So this is precisely the idea for this transport equation that is stationary. Okay, it's not at all our case, but it's connected. You will see why. So actually, we will define this sigma b, the grazing singular set, in this way, as the set of particles So this sigma b is a set of particles xv that belongs to omega times r free, such that the scalar product between n evaluated in xb v times v is equal to zero. So are all the particles coming from the inside and going to the boundary in a point that is a grazing point, okay? So it's like the injection of the grazing set inside the domain. And we will expect that the solution will be singular precisely on that set. Okay. Now, of course, we are considering boundary condition. Up to now, apart from the little idea of the incoming boundary inflow condition, we haven't really followed, we haven't really looked at what happens if on the boundary we have other condition. So actually, we can play a bit with a characteristic. Apart from the case of diffuse condition, where we have to assume that we know which is the velocity with which the solution is reflected, we can really follow. So if we have a diffuse boundary condition and we start from a point x with a velocity v, for example this, what will happen? We will go on the boundary here. We will be reflected with a velocity, it's called there v prime, so this will be our x0, v0, and we take a time t0. So we'll be reflected with a velocity v1, for which we only know that actually the scalar product between n, x1, and v1 is greater than 0. This will be x1 v in this direction, v0. So we are reflecting, we are touching the boundary again, again, and so on. We can go on up to time t equals 0. So at time t equals 0, either we are on the interior, either we can be on the boundary, but we are starting from the initial condition. This is the formal way to define this, but this is precisely what I just picture you here. Now, in the presence of specular cycles, what happens? So you touch the boundary again, and now you're reflected with a velocity that is precisely specular. So you do like this, you see that it's like this, and then again, and so on. But now you know which is the velocity actually, because it's obtained through the formula that I showed before, that is this one written somewhere here. So you can really construct the specular cycles. While when you have bounce back cycle, actually it's the nicest one because it's very easy, you start from a point, maybe in the interior, let's think it's here, you come with this velocity, you come back to the boundary, then you are reflected with the opposite velocity. And then again, and then again, and then again. So you won't move, you stay there. Okay? So it's actually very easy to, even it doesn't seem so, but this is the definition of the point. You just have two points, that is x1, x1, and x2, and that's all. So you have a way to define the backward trajectory that can be seen as generalized characteristic. And actually, you can follow everything till time t equal to 0 and the initial condition. This, for sure, will be the case if we are considering just particles that are moving with the transport equation. It's not the case with Boltzmann equation, because you have interaction. But we will arrive up to there. So let's take the standard transport equation that we have here. So we are considering this dtg plus v scalar equal to 0. And let's see what happened with the different boundary condition that we have. So I already explained a bit to you what happens in the presence of the inflow condition. So you have your domain. You take a particle here at a time t, x, with a velocity v. So if t is smaller than xv, it means that to reach the boundary, I should have had a longer time to go there. So 0 will be somewhere here. So it means that I'm connected with the initial condition. So if the initial condition is G0, I will say that G at the point txv will be equal to G at every point S inferior. So if I took S here, I have to take X minus T minus S V V. And if I take the initial value, this will be the value at time t equals 0 of x minus t, I think, yes, v, v. So I'm connected to the initial condition. The point for which t is less than tb are points coming directly and propagated by the initial condition. While if t is greater than tb or equal, actually, that's why you see why it's necessary to impose the compatibility condition. Because in the case it's equal to TB, you have the choice between the initial condition and the boundary condition. So they have to be compatible in order to have something that makes sense. So if T is greater or equal than TB, actually this can be here or here, it means that you have the time to reach the boundary. So actually the value of g at time t x v will be equal to the value of g at time s. This will be always the same, x minus t minus s v for all t b s t. But then you have to stop at the boundary condition, that is little g at time t minus t b, that is the time needed to reach the boundary, xb b. Okay? So with the inflow boundary condition, you can always know that either you come from the initial condition, either you come from the boundary condition, and everything is fixed. So actually, this condition is the nicest because we can cope with very easily. So, and actually, we will be able even to write the shape of the solution in this case. Okay? While if we are considering the specular or the bounce back reflection, we are obliged to use this kind of generalized.
Yeah.
Yes.
So the possibilities you have explained are in context of
transport equation, yes.
So you are not.
Not at all. Not yet. Okay. I will explain to you why.
But, you are.
Yes. Sorry, but. I'm just trying to give you an idea of what happens for the transport equation in the case of the several different boundary conditions. And then I will explain to you how you can use this to cope with Boltzmann equation.
Yes, but
No. Actually, the diffusion, in a way, is a kind of thermal condition, but
yes.
Not the Maxwellian one, for example.
Okay.
Just this one.
Now,
actually, the case of the diffusion here, you cannot say anything because you don't know where the velocity is. No. Okay, so I was talking about specular and bounce back reflection. In this case, you have to follow these cycles. Actually, even if you are imposing something at the boundary, you are imposing either specular reflection or bouncing back reflection that won't change the velocity of the particle. So the only data that we have is the initial datum. You just have to know at what time you stop to the initial one, because you are just changing the velocity either through the specular reflection, either bouncing back. But the information that you are propagating is always the information of the initial condition. So coming back through the cycles that I just defined before, in a way that was a bit technical, you can link the solution to the initial datum in this way, following the generalized cycle that I just defined. And of course, for diffuse reflection, it's a bit more difficult to explain what happens because you don't really know that the velocity is the average velocity. So you don't have one specific velocity. So the link between the initial condition and the other one is a bit more difficult. Okay. So let me just go a bit farther into the details of our grazing set. So I will do a picture. So according to the different geometry of our set, I will try to do the same because it was nice. I like it. Okay, we can have different grazing sets. So let me start with this point. Remember, the grazing set were the point on the boundary such that their velocity was tangential with the boundary, tangential, like this. Here, this is a grazing point, or here, for example. And then we can have another one here, like, I don't know if I like it. Let's say like this. Okay, so you see that they try to find three different situations. The first one is the situation in which when you are on the boundary here and you go a bit on the left and a bit on the right, you always stay inside the domain. This is a non-convexity point, is the first one, there. So it means, if you want to say like rigorously, that the time back to come backward to the boundary is always positive, either if you consider V or if you consider minus V. So let me just underline the fact that even if I'm already on the boundary, I'm not considering that the time is zero. Because if I move a bit, I can go actually, if I'm here and I move with this velocity backward, I will go there. If I'm here and I'm moving with this velocity backward, I will go there. So the time V will be different from zero in both cases. And actually, this is the worst part of the boundary. Now, you have this case where you have two possibilities. Either if you are here with this velocity, you go backward and you arrive here. So this is actually the outward inflection grazing boundary. And either you are here and you go backward and you have zero in this way, while if you go on the other with the other velocity, it's positive. So this is the incoming, because actually you have to look at this velocity. When you consider this velocity, you are entering. When you consider this velocity, you are going outside. So you have these two sets, and actually what you can imagine is that if a singularity is created here, for the outcoming boundary, nothing happens, the outcoming grazing set, because it's going outside, while for the incoming, it could be that the singularity propagates inside, as it was the case for this one. But actually, this is not possible. You will see later, but just to say. And then we are left with this other possibility, that is the case in which we are always staying outside. So this is the convex grazing boundary, because actually this is a point of convexity of our function, of our boundary. So if you move on from one side and on the other, you always stay outside the domain. So the TB is always equal to zero. So just to note, if you have a point X, V, that belongs to gamma zero V, the convexity, since TB XV is equal to zero, you have that XB XV is equal to X. And this is the same actually for points here, gamma zero E minus. For a point gamma zero E minus, TB XV is equal to zero, so it means the same. Did I mistake? No, it seems to me that it's okay. Okay. So now that we have this definition, actually, we can have a further look at our grazing set that I defined before. So actually, what you can see is that this set can be further divided into several other sets using the definition that I just wrote. So let me just underline. This is gamma zero E plus, gamma zero E minus, gamma zero V, and this one was gamma zero singular. So what happens? Actually, our sigma B is defined as the set of points XV. I was already written there, maybe I should go there. So it's defined like this. So you have that nxb xv v is equal to zero. So for example, you see that if you take a point that is here, on a convexity point, this point will be precisely inside this set. Because whenever you compute, as I told you, TB XV will be equal to 0, XB XV will be equal to X, and so we know that these points are on the boundary, are the grazing one, that X times V is equal to 0. And X times V is equal to 0. So it's okay. This set is included down there. This is the case even for this set, because of the same reasoning. And you can see, because I put this set here, in this part. But whenever you consider points here or here, they are not inside, because the time to reach the boundary is positive for both of them, either in this way, this, or this one. And when you are here at the boundary, you are not at all, you are not obliged to be like tangential even in this way. So they are not inside, but so this is just the part, let's say sigma b contains gamma 0 v, gamma 0 e minus. So this is the part of the grazing boundary that is inside this set. And then you have points that are inside the domain, which are the points that can propagate the singularity. So which are the points that either are propagating from here, either they are propagating from this one. So this is what I tried to write with this gamma SB, the point that propagates from gamma 0S, and gamma E minus B, the point that propagates from gamma E minus, gamma 0 E minus, so this one. So actually, I just put the point on the boundary inside the same set, so that's why you can see this. So actually, it's called like singular set in an improper way because it's not really containing all the singular points, but what it contains and what is important is that it contains the point that propagates inside. And actually, so we are not considering the point that propagates from gamma 0 V and gamma 0 E plus because they are going outside the domain, so we don't care about them. So what it turns out is that Guo proved some regularity about the time backward exit time that you can see here. So actually this TB is always lower semi-continuous. Then we can say that TB and XB are smooth function whenever the scalar product with the normal is less than zero. So actually whenever you are coming to the boundary with a velocity that is not tangential, and no, sorry, with if you have a set, for example, that is not convex, this is the case. And then you can prove that when the TB, when you are considering x0, v0, that is in sigma b e minus b, that means that it's propagating from here, TB is continuous, while if it's propagating from here, so on this side, is discontinuous. So the discontinuity is precisely propagated by the singular grazing set, that set there. So in order to cope with regularity, we need to do something around this point. The idea is that let's remove them. So either if we have a set that is not strictly convex, we have to remove this part in order to prove more regularity. Either we try to consider sets that are strictly convex so that we avoid them. In the case of a strictly convex set, what happens is that, no, it's not strictly convex. Sorry. If you have a convex set, strictly convex set, it doesn't mean that we don't have singularity. Singularity exists, but they are on the boundary. Like here, for example, or all over, actually. But they don't propagate inside the domain. So everything is easier. While as soon as you have a non-convexity point, the singularity can propagate inside. So this is what happens. So, of course, I'm trying to cheat a bit because I'm not really considering the fact that then the particles are interacting even with the boundary, again, in the case of transport equation. But as soon as we have inflow condition, for example, this is the case, so we can define the discontinuity set properly in this way. So we have that the discontinuity set D is made up of two parts. The first part is the discontinuity that we have on the boundary due to the presence of grazing particles. So it's made up of the three terms gamma 0s, gamma 0v, and gamma 0e plus, because we know that gamma 0e minus is not producing any singularity. So this is like the particle that stays on the boundary for all time. They are not moving. And then we have the particles that propagate, but the only one that propagates inside the domain are the one coming from this. So in the discontinuity set, we will put the zero, so the point on the boundary for all time, and then the one propagating inside from the singularity set. While we can even describe the continuity set in this way as the union of three parts. The first part is the initial condition, so the condition that we have at time t equal to zero all over the set, because if we are taking an initial condition that is regular, of course. Then you have a continuity part that is propagating from the incoming set due to the condition, boundary condition that we are taking regular, so it's propagating inside, and it's propagating as well from the part coming from gamma 0 e minus, because we know that TB is continuous at that point. And then we have that one were not propagating, we're just on the boundary for all times, and then the one that propagates from this. So this is the continuity set, are points that are propagating either from the initial condition, because the initial condition propagates inside and propagates regularity, either from the boundary condition, so gamma minus and gamma 0 e minus in time all over the space. So this is the case whenever we have inflow boundary condition. If we have a specular boundary condition or bounce back condition, actually, we need to cope even with the fact that once you reach the boundary with a singularity, then the singularity is reflected, or in this way. So actually, trajectory in the case of specular reflection or bouncing back reflection are propagating singularity, and when they reach the boundary, the singularity propagates. If you have an inflow boundary condition, whenever you reach the boundary with a singularity, then the inflow condition prescribes you the incoming particles, so erase the singularity. And this is the case also for diffuse boundary condition, because whenever you are on a trajectory with a propagating a singularity and you reach the boundary, the diffuse boundary condition diffuses the velocity of the incoming trajectory and erases actually the singularity, so it's no more propagating inside. It can be created again from a non-convexity point, but whenever the singularity touches the boundary, it's erased. This is more or less what happens. So this is, in a way, the picture of what happens in the case of the transport equation with the three, four boundary conditions that I just showed you. Now we will try to make a link with the transport equation and the Boltzmann equation. So we need a reference case that is the linear transport equation with inflow boundary condition. So it's not yet the Boltzmann equation, but we will arrive by step. So we are considering now a step farther. That means that we are adding something linear here, a new that is positive, and a term here that makes the things not homogeneous, but that with some regularity that are enough to prove that we can find a solution. So we have a linear transport equation like this with initial condition and inflow boundary condition. So actually, whenever we require some regularity assumption on H and U that we have here, I don't want to enter into the details, but I mean, you can just a bit understand why everything is very nice in this case. You require some compatibility condition that is, again, to cope with the fact that whenever you are on the point on the boundary at time t equals zero, the compatibility condition has to exist in order to give the continuity for the solution. And then the solution of this linear transport equation is given by the Duhamel formula. So whenever you have the Duhamel formula, you have two possibilities. So you are considering your function f, t, x, v, So either t is less than tb, so it's always the same reasoning. It means that I'm coming from the initial boundary condition. So through Duhamel formula, the solution is given by e minus the integral 0 t nu s ds, where nu actually was supposed to depend on txv, and with the notation nu s, I'm considering, as written there, nu evaluated at x, s x minus t minus s v, so along the trajectory here. Then you have the initial condition, f0 x minus t v, plus the integral from 0 to t, yes, I'm here, e minus 0 s nu tau d tau, h evaluated at time t minus s, x minus sv, v in the s. So this is precisely the value of the function whenever you know that t is less than tb and that you are coming from the initial condition. You can even have an equal here, okay? While if t is greater than tb, then you are not coming from the initial condition, but from the inflow boundary condition. So you can write everything again. So FTXV, but instead of putting F0 here, you have to consider G. And actually, you have to stop at the boundary because you won't go afterwards. So you have E minus the integral from 0 to TB now, nu SDS, G. I have to take g at t minus tb, that is the time that I need to reach the boundary, xbv, and then the term coming from the presence of h plus the integral from 0 to tb, e minus the integral from 0 s, nu tau d tau, h at t minus s, x minus sv, v. So what I wrote here is just a compact way to put everything together using characteristic function of the set t less than tb and t greater than tb. So this is precisely the shape of our function. So everything is fine in this case because you know how the function is done. So you can do estimates on the function. You can see something more about the derivative of the function and something more about the regularity of the function, because you have something that actually, if you want to find something about the derivative with respect to time of this function, you just need to derivate. I mean, it's a long time, there are a lot of terms that has to be derived because you have the presence of time in US, the presence of time inside F through X, F0 through X, then there, but you can do it actually. You have to be patient, and you will see, I wrote in one of the slides, all the computation. So, in this case, Guo proved in 2010 that whenever you have omega that is a smooth bounding domain, and you consider a weight function, and you suppose that the initial data is greater than zero and satisfies this condition, so you have an exponential lambda t here. So you are weighting the initial condition and the incoming condition through this weight function omega. You suppose that all this is less than delta for a positive delta and a lambda that is positive. Then using L2 L infinity estimates through the function that the explicit definition of the function that I gave you before, he was able to prove that there exists a solution that actually weighted by this exponential function is in L infinity and satisfies this estimate. So it's like decaying with an exponential weight here to the equilibrium. Remember that this f, little f, was always the capital F divided by square root of mu. So you are considering that you are converging to the equilibrium in this way. So whenever, and actually you have to reduce to a smaller lambda, so lambda prime here that is smaller than lambda, because of some computation that I'm just hiding inside.
you don't have the Maxwellian here. No, I was saying something. Yes. No, I was saying something. This is not true. Sorry. If I was looking at the equilibrium, but no. This is not the case actually. But you have this exponential here that actually is. Yes. Sorry. You're right. It's not true. I was confusing with the next estimate that are coming afterwards. So okay. Now, whenever you suppose that omega is strictly convex, then whenever you have an initial datum that is continuous and an inflow boundary condition that is continuous, then F is continuous as well, but you have to remove the grazing set. So, except on the grazing set, the function will be continuous because the regularity of the initial condition and of the boundary condition will propagate. Now, maybe we can, I don't know. Maybe it's better to stop here because, like, stating these slides alone is no sense, though. So maybe we will start again afterwards from this side. Thank you.